Good morning, and can I welcome people to the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. This is our fourth meeting of Session 6 on the 7th of October 2021. And can I welcome both the committee, but also welcome Tom, Ian and John Sinclair, who are joining us online. And if you don't mind, gentlemen, we have a few formalities to get through at the beginning of the committee, and then we'll turn to your item. For the members and witnesses who are in blue jeans, please remember to put an R in the chat function each time you wish to come in on a question or a point. The first item of the agenda is indeed to welcome Tess White, who joins us on this committee. And Tess, I would like to invite you to declare any relevant interests that you may have.
Convener, I have no relevant interests to declare.
Thank you very much. For information, Tess is joining us to replace Alexander Stewart, MSP, and I would like to put on my record the thanks to Alexander for his work on this committee, even though we've only met a few occasions in Session 6. And with the consent of the committee, I would like to write to Alexander personally to thank him for his support so far. Are we in agreement with that?
Indeed.
Yes.
Excellent. Thank you. Item two is the matters that we are going to take in private. Oh, please, Paul.
Regarding declarations of interest, just to refer members and public to my register of interest, I'm an existing councillor on East Lothian Council at the moment.
Thank you very much for that, Paul, and the record is so noted. Item two. I'm seeking the committee's agreement to take agenda items 7, 8, 9 and 10 in private. Agenda item 7 is an update to the guidance on the code of conduct. Item 8 is consideration of the committee's work programme. Item 9 is an item in relation to cross-party groups. And item 10 is for the committee to consider an approach to the UK Elections Bill legislative consent motion, which falls to this committee. Are we in agreement to take those items in private?
Yes.
Yep, we are. Thank you. We're now on to agenda item 3, the subordinate legislation. And I would like to welcome Tom Arthur, Minister for Parliamentary Business, and the officials John Sinclair and Ian Thompson, who are joining us online. Tom, would you like to make an opening statement in relation to this item?
I'm waiting. Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning. I was just waiting to be unmuted there. Can I say it's a pleasure to appear before the committee, a committee I have many fond memories of being a member of in the last session, and I congratulate all members on their appointment and indeed congratulate you, Convener, belatedly on your appointment as Convener. At the outset, I just want to put on record my sincere thanks to all who have contributed towards the process of devising this revised model code, in particular key stakeholders, including board chairs, the Commissioner of the Standards Commission, for their input in this process and continued engagement. I want to put on record my sincere thanks to your Scottish Government officials. And finally, I want to offer my sincere thanks to all of those who participated within the consultation who ran over the autumn and winter of last year and early into this year. Convener, the Scottish Parliament demonstrated its commitment to the promotion of high standards in public life by passing the Ethical Standards in Public Life Scotland Act 2000 as one of its earliest statutes. The Act introduced a new ethical framework under which Scottish ministers were required to issue a code of conduct for councillors and a model code of conduct for members of devolved public bodies listed in Schedule 3 of the Act as amended. Each listed public body is required to develop an individual code based on the model code. Both codes of conduct are based on 9 key principles: duty, selflessness, integrity, objectivity, accountability and stewardship, openness, honesty, leadership and respect. Responsibility for ethical standards policy, including the model codes and councillors' codes, rests with the Scottish Government. However, the independent offices of the Standards Commission and the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland have responsibility for the day-to-day operation of the codes. The initial councillors and members' codes were approved by the Scottish Parliament in December 2001 and brought into effect on 1 May 2003. The current version of the Members' Code was amended in 2014. The Scottish Government recognised that a number of new developments have occurred since the Model Code was last reviewed in 2014, and that it is important to take account of such changes and also provide users with an opportunity to contribute to the revised Model Code. A public consultation on the revised Model Code of Conduct was carried out by the Scottish Government in October 2020, running for 16 weeks through to the beginning of February 2021. An analysis report of responses has been published and is available on the Scottish Government website. The consultation sought views on the amendments to the existing Model Code with the aim of establishing whether the proposed revisions made it clearer, easier to understand, raised awareness of the use of social media, changed the rules on gifts and hospitality, highlighted that bullying would not be tolerated, and importantly, whether the proposals were proportionate and appropriate to be included in the Model Code. We also welcome comments on any aspect of the Model Code. A total of 45 responses to the consultation were received from a wide range of stakeholders. The overall view from respondents was very positive, agreeing that the Model Code required updating and that the proposed changes achieved the aim of making it clearer and took account of issues such as the use of social media, and highlighted that bullying and harassment would not be tolerated. We have carefully considered the responses to the consultation, and the proposed changes have been made to strengthen the Model Code and provide clearer information for its users. It is important to emphasise that the ethical basis of the revised Model Code remains unchanged from the original Model Code. Whilst we want to make the Model Code easier to understand, we also want to take the opportunity to take account of developments in our society, such as the role of social media. We also want to strengthen it by reinforcing the importance of behaving in a respectful manner and to make it clear that bullying and harassment is completely unacceptable and should not be tolerated. There is greater emphasis on the requirement for individual board members to take personal ownership of their behaviour by ensuring they comply with their board's code of conduct and they personally take steps to understand their role and compliance. We feel that the proposed changes to the Model Code will help to make it more practical and easier for users to apply with in their everyday roles. In concluding, I would just also want to highlight that, where appropriate, both the Councillors' Code, which is currently being considered by Parliament, and the Model Code have been aligned. And I would now welcome the opportunity to answer any questions that the committee may have on the revised Model Code of Conduct for members of devolved public bodies. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that contribution, Tom. Just before I come to my first set of questions, can I just remind everyone that the actual microphones are operated by broadcast, so we don't need to press buttons or ensure it's on. It will all be taken care of. And I will indicate who's going to speak so that broadcast know who that is. Once again, Tom, can I thank you for that short introduction? And there's a couple of questions that arise from it. And I suppose to take them in reverse order from the way I was originally going to give them to you. I mean, this model code has been the code has been around for a while. Why was it felt, or why was the need felt, to make the amendments at this stage, and indeed not earlier or later? Or does it form part of a rolling programme where the codes will be reviewed regularly?
Thank you very much, Convener. That's an important question. As I touched on in my introductory remarks, the original code was and was revised in 2014. I think the two points I want to highlight, which informed the decision to progress with a revision at this particular juncture, was firstly the amount of time that has passed since 2014. Indeed, I think I touched several times on the issue of social media and bullying and harassment. And I know that there have been significant reflections across the public sector, private sector, and wider society around codes of conduct and whether they're fit for purpose. Indeed, it was something that this committee considered in great detail during the last session of Parliament. So the first point I would make is it really just reflecting the changes that have happened in society over the past 7 years. This was an appropriate juncture in which to consider the code and to revise it. The other point I would make, and I touched on this in my opening remarks, is that the Councillors' Code is also being revised at this moment, and as I made clear, these were introduced at a similar time, at the beginning of the very close to the beginning of the devolution era. So taking this, if because the councillor's code itself was being considered for revision, it was deemed appropriate that there should continue to be alignment between the two codes where appropriate. And so I think it's really, to summarise, it's these two factors which have informed the decision to carry out the revision as now. And of course, going forward into the future, we will always take account of developments and changes, and that will inform future decisions around when it would be appropriate to revise the code in the future.
Thank you, Tom. So it's not a case where the code should be revisited every 5 years, but there needs to be a sensitivity to the changes in social understanding of behaviour, social understanding of attitude, to feed into the code when it's appropriate. Would that be fair?
Yes, I think that's a very good definition, convener. But I think the point you raise about whether or not we should a process set out in advance for an automatic review, given the elapsing of a particular number of years, affects an interesting point, and it's one I'll be happy to reflect on.
And I suppose, flowing from that, I mean, this code is specifically in relation to members of public bodies, and you have talked about the councillor's code of conduct. I suppose I will express it as a concern. Surely there is no need to have identical codes for both, because both those institutions and responsibilities are different. And are you confident that the code for members of public bodies reflects the unique areas that members of public bodies serve on and answer to, rather than just repeating the code and retitling it?
Yeah, I think that's an important point. What I would draw members' attention to, and committee's attention to, is that this is a model code, and it will be up to the individual bodies listed in Schedule 3 of the Act to apply that code as appropriate to their own organisations. Obviously, the codes that they seek to apply will have to be agreed to by Scottish ministers, but the point you make about the need for a flexibility to recognise not just the distinction between public bodies and local authorities, but the variety of public bodies that exist, is why we have a model code as opposed to prescribing one overarching code that each public body must adhere to. So I hope that reassures you in regards to the point that you raised, Convener.
It very much does, Tom, and I think it also reassures the fact that each individual public body needs to look at this specifically, base it on the model code. And I assume that if there is a drift away from the model code, you would expect an explanation of why that item had been omitted.
Yes, you know, clearly. There's obviously the Standards Commission will provide you supporting guidance as well. It will be for individual boards to respond to the model codes should Parliament agree to it, and there will be a process that individual boards will go through. They will submit their revised codes to ministers for consideration. So ultimately, the organisations that are best placed to interpret the model code as it is applicable to their organisation are these respective organisations.
Thank you, Tom. I'm going to pass over to Tess White, who has a few questions, which, if Tom, if it's not for you to answer, please call on John St Clair or indeed Ian Thompson as necessary. Tess.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, the Scottish Government conducted a consultation on revising the model code. Could you say to what extent respondents supported your proposed changes, and how were their views taken into account in the revised code?
Thank you very much, Ms. White. Yes, we conducted a consultation, as I said, from October to February of this year, and we had 45 respondents. There was a variety of views expressed within the consultation, as one would imagine, but overall there was broad support for what we're trying to achieve with the revised model code. And as I touched on in my opening remarks, removal of part of information that was not necessarily applicable or required, and as I also touched on, reflecting the changing mores of the past 7 years, strengthening guidance on, for example, social media around bullying and harassment, and indeed collective responsibility. Another key area where I think there's broad support that emerged from the consultation was in the adoption of a first-person narrative throughout the code as well. And this is really to sort of effectively strengthen the sense of responsibility that individual members of boards have for taking ownership of their responsibilities to understand the code and to adhere to it. I'm happy to bring in Ian Thompson if there's any further points that he thinks would be worth sharing with the committee. I'm sure that I'm giving you the fullest answer possible on this slide.
Minister, you haven't really answered my question, so if I can go back again, is to what extent did the respondents support your proposed changes and how were their views taken into account in the revised code?
I apologise, Ms. White, if you thought I didn't ask the question. The revised code, as it was laid out, received broad support. And, of course, the particular issues that were raised, which are available in the consultation document, were considered and incorporated in around tightening language. But as I don't know if you hear me, it would be possible if I could bring in Ian Thompson, who perhaps can expand on that and give you more detail to address the points that you raised.
Please do, Tom. Ian?
Just to explain, there was strong sense that the revised model code was clear, simple and easy to understand, and particularly so compared to the current model code. Moreover, many also felt that the changes made to the model code had helped to make it more helpful, practical and easy to apply to respondents' everyday roles. We also published the consultation responses as well, so that's on the public record as well.
Thank you, Convener. I'll look at those offline. My second question, Minister, is in Section 6, it talks about inappropriate behaviour. So inappropriate behaviour can be subjective. In your opinion, who actually decides what appropriate and inappropriate behaviour is?
In response to that, I think with regards to... So did you refer to Section 6, Member?
Treatment of other...
Right.
Yes, it's treatment of others.
Treatment of others. Sorry, it's just I want to make sure that I'm referring to the appropriate part of the model code when I'm responding to you. So that's in Section 3, respect and courtesy. Would that be the area you're referring to? Section 3, courtesy.
Under the use of social media, conduct in the chamber and in the committee,
sorry,
and then treatment of others.
Pause one moment. I think you might be looking at the wrong part of the.
Okay. Thank you.
The wrong
okay,
document.
That's my question. Well,
that's
sorry,
a different
my second
part,
question
yeah.
is then why has the model code been written in the first person, and what impact do you expect this will have?
Thank you, Ms. White. I apologise for the confusion. I heard you saying Section 6. The general conduct inspection and courtesy is at Section 3 of the revised model code that is before the committee today. And what it touches and gives definitions of around bullying and harassment and the nature of it. And ultimately, with regards to the point you make about it being subjective, it is about what the individual feels in a particular situation, set of circumstances. And that is a definition that I appreciate has been adopted more widely across a range of institutions. With regards to your point, the question relating to the first-person narrative, as I touched on in my answer to Bina, this is about strengthening the narrative that it is for individual board members to take responsibility, not only to familiarise themselves with the code, but to ensure that they understand the code and adhere to it, and indeed, where appropriate, to seek further guidance, either from the standards officer of their board or their chair, to ensure that they are complying with the code. So it's really about taking ownership and personal responsibility. So that's why the decision is taken to move to a first-person narrative, which was touched upon in the consultation, and I think received broad support. Not there were individuals who created it, but there was broad support for the move to a first-person narrative. And as I say, it's really just about strengthening that ownership that board members are expected to take for their conduct and understanding of the code.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Tess. I'm going to call Edward Mountain now, who I understand has some very specific questions about the code. So again, Tom, if someone else is better placed to answer it on your team, we're fine to hear evidence from them. Edward, can I pass to you, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. My question relates to Category 5, houses, land and buildings. I wonder if you think that Section 4.18, specifically about registrable interests in houses, land and buildings is compatible or at the same standard that is for MSPs? Are the two the same? I'm not convinced they are. And do you think that could lead to confusion?
Thank you very much for your question, Mr. Mountain. Is quite specific. I think it would perhaps be more appropriate if I invited Ian Thompson to address that point.
Thank you, Tom. Can I pass to you, Ian?
Minister, I'm unsighted as to the terms of the MSP's code, so I can't comment on that. What we've done is clearly we've worked with the Standards Commission and the Ethical Standards Commissioner to develop this. This code is aligned with the Councillor's code as well. That's all evidence I can give at the moment anyway.
Thank you very much, Ian.
Edward. Sorry, Tom, I was just going to invite Edward if he had a comment on that.
Thank you. Now I'm unmuted. Thank you. Yes, I mean, what my concern is, Minister, if I can articulate it a bit more clearly, it says in that paragraph, I have a registrable interest where I own or have any right or interest in houses, land and buildings. Now, you'll be aware, I believe, that MSPs, for example, do not have to register their private houses or record them on their register of interest. And I wonder if this specific question may cause confusion to those people on public bodies, that they may feel they have to register their private houses, which goes in excess of what MSPs are requested to do. Minister.
Mr. Mayne, I take the point that you're making and I will reflect on it. As I say, this document itself will be complemented by guidance produced by the Standards Commission, so there may be an opportunity via the guidance to address any confusion that may emerge. Certainly, this is not something that has emerged through the consultation, so to any great extent, but I appreciate the point you're making. It's one that we're happy to reflect on, and indeed, if there is a case, Standards Commission is an independent body, and it's for them to determine what guidance they produce. Certainly, it's something that we can engage with if it is felt, if it is an emerging need to address the point. But as I say, this is not something that has emerged to any great extent through the consultation process. But I do appreciate the point you're making, and I'm happy to reflect on it.
Can I ask you, Tom, was there the intention to include the dwelling house?
With regards to that, I would just ask Ian Thompson to come in, maybe just to give to reiterate the points about how this language was formulated and developed.
I understand how it's developed, and I understand it reflects indeed the council's conduct. I just wonder whether or not the question of whether a dwelling house would be covered was considered, or whether it was not thought about at the time, and I don't mean that in any disrespect or absent way. Ian, I was just wondering whether or not a dwelling house was intended to be caught by that, or it was thought about and the answer was no, and it's not caught by the drafting.
No, I mean it comes down to the actual board member, the board member themselves, and their requirement to declare a registrable interest. Right. If they're required to register an interest under Category 5, in terms of paragraph 4.18, they're required to provide the public body standards officer with the full address of the house, land, or buildings. What is published on the public body's website and made publicly available does not necessarily really require to be detailed. That part 4.18. Has not changed in terms of from the last code, so that's the position of that.
So actually, it's placing the onus on the individual, and hence the reason that it's written in the first party to comply with the second aspect of that, where it is significant and relevant or bear upon the work and operation of the public body.
That's correct.
Thank you. Edward, would you like to come back? Because I know other members of the committee have comments.
I think Bob Dorris does. My only concern is I think it puts an emphasis on declaring your private residence, which as MSPs we don't have to do. And I think it'd be useful to remove private residence from this requirement to bring them in line to what we're doing, which I think would be equitable and fair.
That point's noted, Edward. Bob, can I bring you in?
Thanks. Thank you, Convener. I think you may have mopped up what I was hoping to clarify with your comments, Convener. Minister, I'm just checking. This is not a general obligation to declare your dwelling house. It has to be significant and relevant and bear upon your interest in operation of the public body. So just to put that on the record, that it's not a general obligation to declare that. But I suppose the wider issue that Mr Mountain is raising is that this mirrors the obligations on councillors and not the obligations on MSPs. So perhaps the question we should be asking, perhaps not today but at another time, is the difference between the obligations on councillors and the obligations on MSPs rather than the obligations on members of these boards. So I would welcome your thoughts on that, but just for clarity, that there's no general obligation to register your dwelling house.
Thank you, Bob. Minister?
You know, just on that particular technical point and specific with the implications of the language, I'd invite Ian Thompson to respond to that.
Thank you. Ian?
Minister, there'll be no general requirement to register a dwelling house in this. Again, it's reflected in 4.18 and 4.19. It's an onus on the board member themselves to make that judgment.
Thank you for that. Edward, I know you have a second, more specific point. Can I return to you?
Thank you, Convener. Just going to ask a question now on section 4.20B, which is where at the relevant date the market value of any shares and securities in one specific company or body that I own have an interest of greater than 25,000. Could the Minister please explain where the figure of £25,000 came from?
Minister.
Yes. Yeah, this reflects an alignment to the MSB code in this area, but I'll ask Ian Thompson just to provide a bit more detail on it for you, Mr Mountain.
Thank you. Ian?
Echo Minister's comments. They do that's a reflection on the MSP's code as well. So it's aligned with that. It's also aligned in the Councillor's code. I've got no further comments to make on that.
So can I just press Ian, you don't know where the figure came from or was originally calculated, but it is a figure that's represented in other codes, as you say, both Council
yes,
and MSP.
It's an existing figure from the previous, from the 2014 code as well. I'm uncertain as to the nature of that value, but certainly that's really where the origin of it comes from.
Do you feel that sorry, you may not be able to answer this. Do you feel that the figure's been increased since the original code, or was it 25,000?
No, the figures remained the same.
It's remained the same.
The figures remained the same. It's remained the same. It's remained 25,000 from the previous code.
Thank you. Edward, would you like to come back on that point?
Yes, I'm now totally confused because what the suggestion is that it's aligned to the MSP code, but the previous question I asked to 4.18 isn't aligned to the MSP code. So argument seems to be one way and then the other way. But I mean, £25,000 seems a fairly arbitrary figure. I mean, I don't fully understand that because £25,000 is a lot of money. £10,000 is a lot of money. £1,000 is a lot of money. So I don't understand where that figure's been plucked from. It's not as if £25,000 investment in the Royal Bank of Scotland, for example, would give you a controlling interest. But I don't understand where that figure's come from. It seems to be arbitrary, Convener, and I would like some clarity, please, on how that figure has been selected, because it just rolling it forward doesn't make it acceptable, Convener.
Thank you, Edward. So the clarification is not so much in relation to that figure appearing in here, but why 25,000 seems to have been adopted for a figure for the MSP code, for the councillor's code, and indeed has been reflected in this. Tom, I'm not sure whether anyone who's with you can answer that. Would you undertake to identify? for us where it came from.
I'm happy to take that away. You know, clearly, this is a figure that has been reached previously, and hence it is reflected across a number of codes, including, as has been touched on, the MSP code, which is, of course, a matter for Parliament to decide. So I'm happy to take away and to seek to provide the committee with further information at a later date as to how that particular figure was arrived at in the previous code. But clearly, it's something where there's been a general acceptance of census appearance across multiple codes.
That would be very helpful, Tom. And indeed, if you and those that answered you are unable to ascertain why it's been identified, it would be interesting to hear that as well. Bob, I think you would like to come in.
Yes, I suppose my thanks to Edward Mountain, because he's indicating various issues that perhaps may not have picked up on that might require a little bit more scrutiny. So I think that's helpful to my colleague. But can I just check with the Minister, during your consultation, did individuals and groups broadly support the figure of 25,000? Because I suppose there has to be a figure, and then you seek views on that. So was that generally, were people generally content with that? But second, this is a model code, so if a body thought that number should, or that value should be lower or higher, could they seek to vary that and seek the approval of ministers?
Thank you very much. On the 2 points that you raised, Mr. Burris, I'm going to turn to Ian Thompson for further input in that, if you don't mind.
Sure. Thank you. Ian.
Sorry, Mr. Doris, can you repeat your question? I missed your point there.
Yeah, so this model code was consulted upon. I'm assuming the figure 25,000 was within that model code. Were there any particular objections to that value being placed within the model code? And if not, perhaps individuals felt relatively content in relation to that? So it was to get some information on that. But also, secondly, this is the Minister has made reference to the fact that it can be adapted by various bodies and then seek government approval. So could that figure technically vary from different codes, or is this one baked into whatever code is applied by each body? It must be £25,000.
On the first point, Mr. Doris, I can't recall the responses covering this section there, so I'll need to provide further evidence on that. Yeah. Certainly, from recollection, nothing stood out on that part of that subject there as well. In terms of the 25,000 figure, you're right to point out that boards must align with the model code. I must admit that's not been tested out in terms of the £25,000, and I would think that it would be fairly well. I think we need to be a judgment call in terms of, or a decision made as to where, if there was going to be flexibility within that number. But I would say it probably would be baked in.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Paul, could I bring you in, please?
Thank you, Convener, and excuse me. Good morning, Minister. In your opening statement, you obviously explained the reasons for bringing the revision of the code through, and it just, I suppose, in your opinion, does the revised code place new responsibilities or sanctions on board members, or has the exercise been aimed at increasing clarity?
Thank you, Mr. McLennan. It doesn't change, the new model code doesn't change the sanction regime. What it does seek to do is to provide greater clarity. And as I made reference to earlier, there were certain elements which in the 2014 revision have been removed to improve clarity. There's a move to the first person narrative that I spoke about, and there's the updated and strengthened language concerning social media and bullying and harassment. So this was not about introducing new sanctions. It was about really taking an opportunity to bring the code up to date to reflect societal changes and also to make it, frankly, more user-friendly. And I think it, as reflected in the consultation responses, that is to a large extent what we have been able to achieve.
Okay. Thank you, Minister. Just moving on from that, I mean, if the code is approved, what work will be involved in the rollout and in publicity?
Thank you, Mr. Clinton. There will be a significant amount of with regards to it. I suppose the first point just to stress that as it is a model code, it is for individual boards to take account of the revised model code, should it be agreed to by Parliament, and to apply that to their own revised code. Now, the legislation creates a window, a minimum period of 3 months from parliamentary approval to a board being obliged to begin the process or to have to submit to ministers a revised code. What we are doing is we're giving a six-month period to allow boards to consider the revised code, should it be approved by Parliament, and to redevelop their own codes and to submit that to ministers. The idea about two board meetings take place. So the actual process of boards adopting codes is for them, and of course there will be direct communication from relevant officials and government to ensure boards are aware of the need to commence work should the code be approved by Parliament to update their own codes to reflect the new revised model code. Beyond that, in terms of it will be for individual boards themselves to make sure that they are, and individual members of boards to make sure that they are fully advised with the details of their own codes, which will of course have to reflect the revised model code. But where, for example, in terms of the process of individual board members, well, it is incumbent upon them to familiarise themselves with the terms of their board's particular code. We do in the Scottish Government Public Bodies Union provide induction workshops, which the Standards Commission and the Commissioner lead sessions on. The Standards Commission can also, to an extent, provide guidance and ad hoc sessions where resource allows. So there's a variety of support that's available, but principally it will be for boards to reflect upon the model code subject to Parliament's agreement, and within 6 months to submit to ministers their revised codes, taking account of the new model code, and subject approval of ministers, it will then be for individual board members to ensure that they are informed and up to date and take ownership of their board's own revised code. I apologise for that convoluted way of having to express that, but I hope it conveys the point.
No, thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Minister. Just a couple of matters, I suppose. The one that's most relevant in respect to this code is the training that's going to be required both for new members and existing members. How do you plan to meet that need?
Thank you, Convener. I think I touched on some of these points in my mm-hmm. previous answer to Mr. McMillan. Effectively, as has been touched upon, by number of committee members in relation to the first person narrative. It's about personal ownership from someone for board members. If one is appointed as a member of a public board, it is incumbent upon that individual to familiarise themselves with their own code, and they will have that provided to them by their chair. I mean, reference to the induction workshops from your appointees to public boards, the Public Bodies Unit in the Scottish Government helps to facilitate, and made reference as well. That also includes presentations from the Standards Commission and the Commissioner. So there are these opportunities. I think it's also incumbent upon individual board members to seek opportunities to continually update their awareness and understanding of how the code is applicable to their conduct and the operation of their board. So I appreciate that's placing a heavy emphasis on individual responsibility, but I hope that's balanced by the support that is provided for new members as they're appointed. And of course, there is the resource of the standards officer within each board, who individual board members can turn to seek further clarity or guidance upon the code and how it is and its applicability. And to complement the codes of individual boards, there is guidance from provided from the Standards Commission, and that will be is under development. And should this model code be adopted by Parliament, guidance by the Standards Commission will be published on their website. But I hope that, while placing a heavy emphasis on individual responsibility, then there is a range of support available, including at the point of induction and going forward on a continuous basis.
I'm very grateful, Minister. And just really in conclusion, just to clarify some matters in this, the evidence session, It is for this committee to report by the 27th of October in relation to the motion that you've brought before us, and there are a number of outstanding matters that have been highlighted in the evidence. Can you undertake that this committee will have your responses to those so that we can attach it to the report for the chamber for the 27th of October? Is that something that you can agree to?
Yes, I'm certainly happy to respond by then to the committee and will endeavour to provide the most fulsome answers possible. I'm very grateful to the committee for their probing questions and scrutiny. It has exposed some areas which perhaps haven't been considered before, and particularly the line of questioning from Mr. Mountain. I'm sure a number of us will want to reflect upon that, not just specifically to the Councillor's Code or the Model Code, but the MSP Code as well. So I'm very grateful to the committee for their contribution this morning, and I'll be happy to write back to the committee ahead of the date that you referred to.
I'm grateful for that confirmation. Thank you. At that point, I'm going to finish Agenda Item 3, which is the evidence. And can I formally, before I do so, thank the Minister and the officials, in particular Ian, for attending today and giving evidence to this committee. Thank you. We're now going to move to Agenda Item 4, for which I will request that the Minister stays as we move to a slightly more formal element of this. I would now like to invite the Minister to formally move and speak to Motion S6M01125, that the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee recommends that the Model Code of Conduct for members of devolved public bodies be approved. Minister.
I'll limit my remarks, Convener, to simply saying formally moved.
I'm grateful. It is now an opportunity for members of this committee to make submissions. Edward, can I move to you?
Thank you, Convener. Sorry, I was gazing happily at the microphone to make sure I was unmuted. But my first comment, Convener, if I could make, I absolutely believe is in the interest of all public bodies, elected individuals, to comply with the highest standards of behaviour and openness to the people that elected them or appointed them. And I would never move from that position. However, I am concerned that paragraph 4.19 does not actually reflect what is in the paragraph 4.... what is it required for MSPs. In fact, it is a more onerous declaration, whereas the explanation for paragraph 4.20b was put in there because it complied with exactly what MSPs were required to do. So we have a slight mismatch. I Convener, would not be in a position to want to hold this up, but I do believe that it is important that members of public bodies do not have to declare their private residence as part, or be made to think they have to declare their private residence as part of the declaration that they may wish to make, because I think it should be out with the scope as it is for MSPs. And as far as the £25,000 figure is concerned, it appears extremely arbitrary to me, and therefore that is why I seek clarity on it. I mean, I know you will be considering our position because we have limited time before the matter has to be considered by the Parliament. What I would say is that I do not wish to hold this up, but should this matter come to the Parliament and I have had insufficient answers to my questions, I reserve the opportunity to comment on the LCM when it comes to the Parliament, because at the moment I don't feel that it is equitable and fair to members of public bodies, and nor have we had a suitable explanation of the figure of 25,000. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you for that, Edward. And I note, and on the record, is the position with regard to this statutory instrument, subject to the information that the Minister has agreed to send to us from your position. I would just, and this is not a criticism, it's merely a clarification, that when Ian gave evidence with regard to the 25,000, he mentioned both the MSP's code of conduct, but also the councillor's code of conduct, to draw it in a line to that. So I just merely put that out there to be on the record. Is there any other member of the committee who would like to make a submission? My apologies, Bob, I can't see the chat function. Is there anything that you would like to say? Maybe no, but...
No, I'm content, convener. Thank you.
I'm grateful. And on the undertaking from the Minister, Tom, can I just return to you if there's anything you would like to say by way of closing remarks before I formally put this to the committee?
I would just wish to reiterate, convener, I'm very grateful to the committee for their consideration of this motor code, and as I previously indicated to you, I will speak to provide a response as soon as possible, certainly ahead of the date that you indicated is required, and we'll seek to address and specifically the points raised by Mr. Mountain and provide clarity for that as possible.
I'm grateful. Well, the question is that motion S6M01125 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yep, agreed.
Then, excellent. I understand, Edward, that you wish to abstain on that decision. I'm grateful to put that on to
the...
Yes. Can I move to a formal vote so that your position is preserved, Edward? I'm going to call a division, and I will come to each member of the committee and ask for your vote. Bob Dorris, for, against, or an abstention?
I'm agreeable to the motion, convener.
So that's four.
Four.
I'm grateful. Paul McLennan?
Yeah, four, convener.
Four. Edward Mountain?
Abstain, convener.
I'm grateful, Edward. Tess White?
Abstain, convener.
And I'm going to vote for this motion, subject to the assertions from the Minister. The results are therefore 3 votes for and 2 abstentions. The matter will now, the motion is now passed and will pass to the Chamber. Could I confirm with members that they are content for me to sign off the committee's report to Parliament, which will be an essential element of this?
Yep, agreed.
Convener?
Yes, Bob.
Can I just ask, in signing off the report, will that be a formal written report, or will it just note the division in the committee this morning? If there's some nuances around the reassurances that the committee may or may not wish to seek from the Minister, and there may be a slight variance and nuance around that, so I'd be quite keen to get that clarified.
Thank you for that question on a clarification. It's a formal report that not only shows the vote, but also shows the evidence that we heard in the matters that are outstanding, which is why I've invited the Minister to respond in time for that to be attached to the report, so that it comes before the Chamber when it makes its decision.
If the committee is taking a view on the additional information that we would like to have from the Minister on the reasons for that, I would be keen to have a look at that before that was issued.
Absolutely, Bob. The response from the Minister will be passed around all committee members, and we will have an ability to talk about it, let me put it that way, that we're satisfied.
It will return to the committee for the committee to look at what we are reporting to Parliament on
this
matter.
We can agree.
We're reporting to Parliament. Is that correct?
My apologies, Bob. I didn't mean to interrupt you. We can agree by correspondence the report that's going to go to the Chamber. It's just it requires a signature as well. So the committee can agree by correspondence?
Fine.
Yeah. Thank you.
As long as we can agree by correspondence. Yes, thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. 1, 2, 5. We now move to agenda item 5, the cross-party groups. It is for this committee to take evidence from Maurice Golden, MSP, who is attending in person, on the proposed CPG on the circular economy, and then we'll hear from Pauline McNeill, MSP, who will be joining us remotely on the proposed CPG on medicinal cannabis. Good morning, Maurice. Thank you for coming to the committee. And you are our first cross-party group in person, so welcome to that. Can I hand over to you to give us an introduction about the intentions of the cross-party group and how you see it going forward?
Yeah, thank you, convener. As your members will be aware, the circular economy is an economic system which it revolves around circulating materials in as high value state as possible for as long as we can in order to extract the maximum value from them. And that means that it encompasses a whole variety of areas and sectors which are relevant to the people of Scotland as well as decision makers in this Parliament. And the purpose of the group is really to both explore and address many of these issues. We had 9 MSPs from the Conservatives, SNP and Labour attending the initial meeting of the group, and we've elected or nominated 4 of those to serve as convener and deputy convener, again cross-party. And we also have, as part of our secretariat and treasury, 4 environmental organisations which will help support the group's functions. I think perhaps the biggest challenge for the group will be deciding which topic to begin with, but we're very much looking forward to being established if the committee approves and exploring and addressing many of these issues.
I'm very grateful. I hope you're open to some questions from the committee, and I'll take convener's privilege by starting. And I think you hinted on it there in your last statement. It is an enormous cross-party group that covers many areas and indeed overlaps a significant other cross-party groups. And in the application, you identified the unique concept that warrants very specific consideration for the circular economy. Would you like the opportunity just to go into that a little bit more detail?
Yeah, I mean, there's obviously a plethora of areas, some which are very much distinct to the circular economy, CPG, for example, waste, recycling, incineration, the waste hierarchy is very much exclusive. But I do see the opportunity, for example, in doing joint CPGs with, for example, on renewable energy, where there is a synergy with an existing CPG. And that's something I've done in the past with the Nordic countries CPG, which I established last term. So there is an opportunity to work across, but there's other areas, including textiles, for example, that hasn't seen a lot of sector focus in this Parliament to date. And I see the CPG as really adding value to our political discussions, but also to the people of Scotland.
Thank you. That's very helpful. So really the position that the CPG is taking, although it crosses a number of other areas, is almost unique in your ability to bring those areas together and follow the process around the whole system.
I think so. And, you know, another area which would perhaps overlap is in the area of housing. But I think the CPG offers a distinct vantage point in which to approach how we build our houses, how we heat our homes. And I think that's where we can add value to existing CPGs and complement their activities.
Thank you. Is there any from the committee that has a question that they would like to put to Maurice? Ah, we have come to the end of the questions. Thank you very much for attending. Again, with regard to the procedural matters, we close this aspect of it and deal with the actual registration in a separate one. You're more than welcome to stay, Maurice, but we're going to hear evidence from another cross-party group. And if you're not here, then we will, of course, be in touch. But thank you very much for your time this morning.
Thank you so much. I've got to go across the way to my other committee now. So.
I appreciate that. Thank you very much indeed. Do we need to pause to get Pauline in? Can we have a short suspension of this committee to allow Pauline to come onto Blue Jeans? I'll call an end to the suspension and issue committees welcome to Pauline McNeill, MSP, who is here to talk about medicinal cannabis. Pauline, can I hand over to you?
Good morning, convener. Yes, it's medicinal cannabis, not medical cannabis, but medicinal cannabis. I'll see why. First, convener, thanks to Sam Curry, your clerk, for the support she's giving us and trying to set the group up, which I hope the Standards Committee will be satisfied with. So it's probably the first group of its kind. It doesn't overlap with anything else. And I was running informal meetings with a really amazing group of people who believe that there are credible health benefits to the use of cannabis. And I thought that probably there would be interest to set up a formal cross-party group. So we've already done quite a bit of work. So the group seeks to better understand the benefits of medicinal cannabis and recognise case studies indicating its positive impact on patients suffering from a variety of conditions. And it also seeks to support patients' rights to get access to the medicine. You might be familiar with some high-profile cases of young Cole, for example, who cannot currently get access to prescribed Bedrolite and has to pay for it privately. But Cole being able to take this medicine has reduced his convulsions by an incredible fact that he's hardly had any episodes. So for some patients, it is absolutely life-changing. And we've heard evidence in the informal sense from people who speak to the fact that some of very serious health conditions have simply been cleared up by the use of certain types of cannabis products. So it's in the public interest that we would examine the evidence-based research and seek to investigate case studies for those with chronic illnesses who would benefit from medicinal cannabis. So the topics that we would anticipate was access to Bedrolite and other cannabis-based drugs, which are have a high cost coming into the country, more difficult now because of Brexit. A red card that the state of Colorado in the US runs called MedCan, which is a card for medical cannabis users to show that their need is for health benefits. Patients' rights, that's the human rights of patients to access this versus public health. And I personally feel quite strongly that patients, if they feel it's beneficial to them, should not be prevented from the use of a cannabis product, of which there are many, because of any laws or judgment calls on people who use it. Why did I do this? My own father, who had very severe arthritis, used to say to me that if we ever legalised cannabis, would I be the first person to go and get him some so he could alleviate his pain and suffering, which he believed it would have, but being a law-abiding person, he sadly passed 5 years ago and didn't get the chance. But for many people, they believe that it will alleviate conditions like arthritis. So that's what drove me to do this work. So reducing stigma using the evidence base and working with the NHS, in which we have a good relationship with the NHS, because there is some political resistance to this, but there's also a bit of interest in it as well. And also, lastly, legislation for cannabis growers. So we want to explore whether there should be legislation. You probably noticed that a lot more people do just take cannabis tablets or cannabis products for health reasons, but it's becoming big business now. So we want to make sure that it's not something that only big business can control. So we're interested in cannabis growing. So, convener, that's the main purposes. Actually, maybe just to say that Rona Mackay agreed to co-convene it, Oliver Mindell, Conservative member Miles Briggs, who has done a huge amount of work in this as well, Monica Lennon, MSP, who's been part of the informal grouping, Paul Sweeney, MSP, and Pam Duncan-Glancy have already signed up. A number of individuals, which are in your papers, organisations, patient-led engagement and access to Scottish patient subgroup called PLEA, Scottish Cannabis Consortium and the MS Society Scotland. I would expect a lot more interest in this should Standards approve our application. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that evidence, Pauline. And again, I'll open up to questions for the committee, but take my privilege as convener to go first. The purpose, as you've stated, is about primary purpose is to collect and recognise the value of case studies. That is clearly a hugely important way of finding out the actuality of the use of medicinal cannabis in real life. Do you see there being a significant number of case studies on which you, the CPG, can base further evidence and research going forward?
Yes, I do. We will have to use international examples and examples which may be anecdotal, but nonetheless are very compelling. We have had the Chief Medical Officer and the Chief Pharmaceutical Officer address us and some agreement that we do need to ensure that we're running proper trials so that it is legal for GPs to prescribe certain cannabis products just now, but GPs perhaps don't have the confidence that they might have. So trials are really important. So we want to make sure that we're pushing that door. And I feel that that door is partially open for us. I think there's a lot of interest in it. But as you would expect, any government and any medical system, they want it tried and tested.
And do you feel that the CPG will give groups and other individuals perhaps the confidence to share evidence with you that they don't feel able to share at the minute with other organisations or indeed government?
I'm absolutely in no doubt, convener, that I think the platform that this would give people who have felt no connection to be able to influence decision makers would be absolutely invaluable, which is why I think it's important now to formalise that work that we're doing. And I think there'll be a great deal of interest in it, and hopefully we can work constructively with the medical profession and the government to do something in the next few years.
Thank you. Are there any questions from other members of the committee? No? Excellent. Well, Pauline, as you know, after your little evidence session, we'll move into another agenda item to actually take the decision, and the committee clerks will be in touch with you, the outcome of that decision in due course. But can I thank you for coming along to the committee this morning and expressing the views and opinions of, hopefully, the new CPG. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
We now move to agenda item 6, the cross-party group approvals. So if I can deal with the CPG application for the circular economy first. Are there any comments or questions before I formally move to ask? Tess?
Just to support it, I think it's a very good CPG, mm-hmm. convener.
Thank you. Are there any objections to the CPG being formally founded? No? Established, thank you. Formally established, good. Can I move to the medicinal cannabis, and I'll pronounce it correctly this time. Are there any comments from the committee before we take a decision? Yes, Tess?
Also like to say a very good CPG, fully support it.
Excellent. Are we agreed that the CPG for medicinal cannabis be formally recognised? Yes? Grateful. We're now going to move to item 7. Which we will conduct in private. So can I just call a short suspension